Let us pray. Heavenly Father, our Lord and Master, we thank you for the gift of a brand new day. Thank you for blessing us throughout all of this week and bringing us to the end of the working week today. We give you all the praise, we give you all the glory, give you all the honor for your faithfulness and your goodness towards us, your children. We thank you. Father, we want to commit this morning devotion platform into your hands. This platform that you yourself created for us. We ask that you be present amongst us today. You send your Holy Spirit to be with us and to move us and to feel us and to use us today. Let us experience you differently today, Father. Father, we are sinners and we ask for forgiveness for our sins. Open up our eyes of understanding today and let us hear your word and let your word sink in today. And so that those words will be words that become part of our lives, so that we use them and become the disciples that you want us to be. Father, we also commit those who are on their way onto the platform. We pray that you will yourself will send your angels to wake them up and get them here to worship you and to experience you. Incline your ears towards us, towards our prayers and our petitions. Hear them and answer them. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, amen. Hello, good morning, everyone. Welcome once again to the morning devotion platform. As the psalmist says, we should praise the Lord our God every morning and every day and all day. So with that in mind, let us go into our time of worship.
Lord, my heart cries out, glory to the King, my greatest love. Open my ears, let me hear your just to see you, to behold you as my King. Lord, if I find favor, come on, say, find favor in your sight. Lord, please, Lord, please.
Love is who you are. be your name, O God.
Amen, amen, amen. We thank God for that wonderful time of worship. He is so worthy to be praised always and every day. Amen. It is now time for our general prayers for this morning. And this morning, our general prayers will be led by Sister Lydia. Let us kindly welcome and receive her.
Good morning. This morning, we're praying for the Holy Spirit impacting our children. If you have no children, go ahead and pray for others on this platform or children that you know as a seed of faith. In our first prayer today, we'll say, Father, thank you for today. Thank you for the children you have given us. Thank you for making our children overcomers and conquerors in your kingdom. In Jesus' name, let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the gift of a new day. Thank you for giving us this wonderful day, bringing us to the end of a week. We thank you for the children that you have given to us, O Lord. Thank you for making our children overcomers and conquerors in your kingdom. Your word says, Lord, children are an heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward. Happy is the man that has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies in the gate. Thank you, God, that our children are equipped. Oh God, you have equipped our children to even be able to speak with the enemies in the gate. Oh God, our children will possess the gates of their enemies. Oh Lord, thank you because they have become overcomers and conquerors. Thank you, God, that Father God, our children are not living a defeated life, that no matter what we see with our eyes, we know and we declare today that our children are overcomers. They are conquerors, O Lord, in Christ. And we cover them, O Lord, even with the covering that you have given us as parents. We pray for them today, Lord. Thank you for giving us to, children to us as our heritage. And we thank you, God, because they are our reward. Oh, Lord, you have given us children as reward. And we thank you, God. We thank you that we shall not be ashamed of the children that we have, but our children shall be conquerors and overcomers in Jesus' name. Amen. In our second prayer today, we'll say, Father, Lord, thank you that you have given each of my children unique gifts, talents to use for your glory. Help them to discover their talents and use their abilities to build up and edify those around them for the kingdom of God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for my children. I thank you for the gifts that you have equipped each of my children, God. I thank you, God, that the talents that you have given to my children are to be used for your glory. My God, I pray that everywhere that they go, in the schools, O Lord, in the places of work, O Lord, that God, my children will use their talents to build up others and to edify others around them for the kingdom of God. Your word says, now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administration, but the same Lord. Father, I thank you for the talents that you have equipped my children with, oh God. And Father God, I thank you that God, their gifts are really for your glory, oh God. And so, Father, even as I nurture my children, as I raise them in the fear of the Lord, that God, those talents and gifts will be shaped, oh God. They will be directed correctly, oh God, to be used differently, oh God, to be used in ways that bless other people around them, to draw other children in school to the name of the Lord, to believe in the God that they believe in, because God, you have equipped them with beautiful talents and gifts, O Lord, and I glorify them for them, Lord. I thank you that God, as we discover them, as we help them to discover that God, these talents, O Lord, that we will direct them correctly, O God, that we will not discourage our children from the things that you have given them to do, but God, that we will nurture those talents to the glory of the Almighty God. In Jesus' name, amen. In our third prayer today, we'll say, Father God, by your Spirit, open the eyes of the understanding of my children to the need for and the importance of living a pure life according to your word. Help them not to conform to the patterns of this world. Let us pray. Father, your word says, open thou mine eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of thy law. You also say, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his ways by taking heed thereto according to thy word. My Father, I know there's so many things that tag and pull at my children. God, I pray today that, Father God, my children, their eyes shall be opened, O Lord. That Holy Spirit, partner with my children, O God. Partner with them to cause them to understand. To understand, O Lord, the need to live a pure life, my God. Father God, that everything my children are engaged in, the friendships that they have, O Lord, the things they watch, O God, YouTube videos and all the internet, social media that they're on, my Father, that God, they shall be conscious to live a pure life, that they will make pure choices, O Lord, that they will keep their ways pure before you, my God, because Father, you tell us that without being pure, without that holiness, we cannot see you. We shall not see you, God. I need my children to see you in their daily life, O God, to see you in the situations of their lives, and Father, help them to understand that it is so important for them to keep a pure life, O God, to live according to the word of God, that no matter what is in fashion, what in vogue, what is pulling at them, that Lord Jesus, they shall make their stand known. They shall choose wisely. They shall be like the young Daniel, Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego that said, we shall not eat that food. We shall not watch that video. My Father, help my children to make those good decisions, oh God, that they may live a pure life in Jesus' name. Amen. In our fourth prayer today, we'll say, Father, in your mercy and kindness, strengthen my children with your wisdom and their decision-making by the Holy Spirit, so that they glorify and honor you in their lives. Let us pray. Father God, I pray for my children today. Have mercy on them, O Lord. Show them kindness, my God. Show my children, give them the strength, O God, the ability to stand firm and make wise decisions. Holy Spirit, come into my children's life. Activate that part of you, Holy Spirit, that causes them to hear the voice of the Master, to hear the voice that says, this is the way, walk ye in it. Father, your word says, as for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skills in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel heard understanding in all visions and dreams. My Father, I pray that my children's lives can glorify you, that my children can live a life, a daily decision-making life that glorifies you, that elevates Jesus above all things, God. I thank you, Father. Give them the strength, even in the face of adversity, in the face of friends making other choices, that God, they can say, no, I will not do that. That they can stand firm for you, Jesus, and make you proud, God. Father, I pray that you bless my children with this ability, God, that they cannot just follow peers, oh God, that the peer pressure shall not overcome them, oh Lord, that they will not want to be part of the clique when it's against your word, oh God, that Father, they will make those choices. I thank you and I honor you in Jesus' name. In our fifth prayer, we'll say, Father, make our children strong and courageous in you. Help them to grow in confidence and perfect love, casting out fear of the future and trusting in you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, I bring my children before you. Father, make my children strong and courageous in you, O God. Father, let the word of God that dwells in them, even as you have told us to fill ourselves with your word, with the knowledge of you, so that that knowledge of you can give them confidence, O God, when they face situations, that they will have confidence in you, that their God is always with them, that they are living in perfect love, O God. And Father, let them not fear the future, no matter how bleak it looks, my God, that they can look to the future and know that they have confidence in the living God and trust you always. Your word says, only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou may prosper whithersoever thou goest. Father, I bless my children with this blessing of having courage in you, having confidence in the Almighty God, trusting you at all times, that God, all the discouragements that come their way, all the things that cast fear in their direction, my God, that they can look at that and look up and know where their strength comes from. I thank you, my God, and I honor you in Jesus' name. In our sixth prayer today, we'll say, Father, we pray that our children begin to hear the voice of destiny calling, and that by this divine calling, they begin to find and occupy their place in Jesus' name. Yes, Lord. Father, I thank you. I thank you for this, Lord. I pray today that my children, oh God, will begin to hear the voice of destiny calling, God. That, Father God, by this divine calling, that they begin to find and occupy their place in you. Your word says, wherefore also we pray always for you, that our God would count you worthy of this calling and fulfill all the good pleasures of his goodness and the work of faith with power. Father God, today I pray for each of my children. Father God, I pray the Lord Jesus, the voice of Jesus, they will hear your voice calling them to their divine calling, God, that they will begin to find that place where they fulfill purpose for you, God. That God, they will begin to find the direction to walk in, oh Holy Spirit, partner with my children. Cause them to hear you and obey you. That when they hear you, they obey that voice calling them, so that God, they can fulfill all the good pleasure of your goodness and the work of faith with power. In Jesus' name, amen. In our seventh prayer today, we'll say, Father, give every parent on this platform the wisdom and knowledge to raise our children in the way and admonition of the Lord, bringing glory to your name. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, I commit every parent on this platform. I commit myself to you, O God. And Father, I ask that, Lord, your wisdom and your knowledge shall be the yardstick that we use as we raise our children, God. That, Father God, we will raise them in the ways of the Lord, in the admonition of the Lord, that we will be amazing stewards of the Lord for this wonderful gift that you have given us, even the children in our homes, Lord. Your word says, and ye fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. Father God, I pray that you help us. Help me as a parent to guard my mouth, O Lord, to guard my heart. That God, our children do things that may provoke us. The Lord Jesus, help us to remember that we also are the priests of the Lord above our children. That God, we do not provoke them to sin against you. Father God, I thank you and I praise you for the opportunity to raise our children in the fear of the Lord. And God, I pray that we will do a wonderful job and make you proud and bring children to you, even the reward for our Lord Jesus Christ. That God, we will bring you this blessing, God, having fulfilled our jobs correctly. Thank you, God. Thank you for answers to prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. We thank God for answers to those general prayers this morning for our children. Amen. Amen. It is now time for the word, the Bible reading. The Corinthians says, the words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life, says the Lord. And this morning's Bible reading will be taken from Psalm 105, verses 12 to 24. Psalm 105, verses 12 to 24. And this morning, our sister Julie Hines will be reading for us. Let us kindly welcome and receive her.
Good morning, brothers and sisters. I'll be reading from the New King James Version. When they were few in number, indeed very few, and strangers in it, when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he permitted no one to do them wrong. Yes, he rebuked kings for their sakes, saying, do not touch my anointed ones, and do my prophets no harm. Moreover, he called for a famine in the land. He destroyed all the provision of bread. He sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They hurt his feet with fetters. He was laid in irons until the time that his word came to pass. The word of the Lord tested him. The king sent and released him. The ruler of the people let him go free. He made him lord of his house and ruler of all his possessions, to bind his princes at his pleasure and teach his elders wisdom. Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob dwelt in the land of Ham. He increased his people greatly and made them stronger than their enemies. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much, Sister Julie, for reading that word for us this morning. It is now time for a charge to be brought to us this morning. The word of God that is sent to us through the Spirit, Holy Spirit to nourish us, to feed us, and to lead us. And this morning, the charge will be brought to us by one of our own, Brother Wally. Let us receive and welcome Brother Wally.
Good morning, everyone. First of all, let me just say, I just want to thank Pastor Linka for this opportunity. I do not take it lightly. I appreciate the platform to speak. And Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray that you speak through my mouth. I pray that every word I speak will be beneficial to everyone who hears it and will be a blessing to everyone on this platform, in Jesus' name. Okay, so this morning I'll be speaking on approve to approve. And we've read that scripture and we'll go into it in more detail. But I'd like to start here. Before any manufacturer, there are many manufacturers in this world, but before a good manufacturer releases a product, the first thing they do is they test it, they prove it. They prove it before it can be released for sale or for use by the general public. And in the same way, our God is the ultimate businessman, is the ultimate manufacturer. He created you, and he says you are fearfully and wonderfully made. So before he creates you and before he sends you out to do anything that he's ordained you to do, he has to test you and he has to prove you, just like any manufacturer would. You see that in the pharmaceutical industry, before they release any drugs for use, they first put those drugs through all kinds of tests. Verse 19 in that scripture we read said, until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. It tested him to make sure that he was fit for use. Any producer, any manufacturer, any inventor, before they can actually release any product, they have to make sure that it's proven. They have to make sure that it's approved for use in the things that they had, that it was designed for. The Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5, it says, before I formed thee, I knew thee and ordained you to be a prophet to the nation. So God does not make a mistake in whoever he creates or whatever he designs or whatever he sends out for use. Everybody, every one of us has a great destiny. Every one of us has been designed and destined to do something great. But before we can start to walk in our destiny, before we can start to do those things that God has called us to do, as a great manufacturer would, he has to prove us. He has to test us to make sure that we are ready to go do what he has called us to do. The same thing, before God could use Joseph, and that's because that scripture that we read is referring to Joseph. Before God could use Joseph to deliver the Israelites, before God could use Joseph to deliver Israel and his children, he had to prove him. He had to prove him. He had to test him. He had to try him. So the same way, before God can use us for any great destiny, before God can use us for any great thing, he has to prove us so that we can be approved to do everything that he has called us to do. Jesus was tested in the wilderness. Abraham was tested. David himself was tested. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 34 to 36, it talks about how David fought a lion and a bear. And so that made him prepared and approved to fight Goliath. And it took down Goliath with one stone. But before he could do that, he had to be proven in the wilderness. When nobody was watching, when nobody was looking, he had to go through trials. He had to go save his father's flock. He had to go save his father's sheep from the lion and the bear. And that prepared him well enough. So before God can use us for anything that is great, anything that is dynamic, before God can accomplish certain things in our lives, he has to prove us to make sure that we are capable of handling those things that he wants to give us, that we're capable of doing the things that he has called us to do. So what does it mean to be proved? What does it mean to prove something? What does it mean to prove something? There are many, like I said, many manufacturers will go through this. They'll test products, they'll prove products. Proving and testing kind of mean the same thing, but it's not quite the same. So what does it mean to prove something? It means to verify that no matter what happens, it will do what it was designed to do within the parameters it was given. to prove something means to verify that no matter what, it's going to do exactly what it was called to do, and it won't deviate, it won't go from the right or to the left, it won't go to the right, it won't go to the left, it won't do anything else but exactly what it was created to do. It means going through a process to make sure that it is reliable. It is reliable in tough times. It is certified to be reliable, to be with, capable of withstanding tough times and tough environments. It means to push something to the limits, to see how to perform in extreme situations. You see, astronauts, before they get sent up to space in any rocket ship, all the different parts of that rocket ship must have been tested and proven to make sure that it can handle all the extreme temperatures, all the extreme situations that they find in space. So they will take every part of the rocket, they'll put it through extreme heat, they'll put it through extreme cold sometimes. Sometimes they'll put it through extreme vibration to see if this thing shakes a lot when it's in space or when it's coming down back into Earth, to make sure that the rocket doesn't fall apart and doesn't kill everybody inside, because there are precious lives on board. So you see that the more important something is, like you look at drugs, for instance, before drugs can be released to markets, normally they are supposed to be tested and proven for years. It takes them years. Sometimes it takes them 10 years. That's why sometimes drugs are so expensive, because they're trying to make back all the money they've invested in testing the drug. It takes them billions of dollars and years and years, because they are trying to give drugs to people to put in their bodies. And so if it doesn't do exactly what they claimed it could do, it could really turn around and harm somebody who takes it. Or it could have all kinds of side effects. So everything that is created, everything that is manufactured, everything that is designed for something, for use for something, must be pushed to the limits to see how it performs in extreme situations, to see if there are any side benefits that we don't want. So to what end? So why do we need to test it? So that we can be approved for use, so that it can be purified. Because if you find anything during the testing period and it's not something that is good enough, then you take it back to the design lab, you test it, you prove it, you repair the thing that is not 100% perfect, you tweak it, you refine it. That's why the Bible talks about the refiner's fire. You refine it, you make sure that it's fit for use. In Genesis chapter 18, verse 18 to 19, God was talking about Abraham. He said, how can I not tell Abraham what I'm going to do in this situation? He says, because I know he will surely become a great nation. Before that verse, God had already blessed Abraham that he'll become a great nation. But God did not confirm that it was definitely going to happen until that verse. He said, he will surely become a great nation, for I know him. I have proven him. That means that he has been approved to inherit the promise. That means that he has been qualified to walk in the blessing because he was proved. Right. So in that same verse, Abraham had become approved because God knew that he had passed the test. He had passed the proving. He had showed that he would command his household and he would command them in justice and in judgment. So God was able to manifest that in his life. God was able to manifest that promise that he was going to become a great nation in his life, because he knew that that nation would stand for justice. That nation would stand for judgment. And Abraham had walked through the proving, and Abraham had proved it. And Abraham would not do anything different. So God knew he was going to do exactly what God wanted a great nation to do. And so that great nation manifested in him. So before God can manifest your destiny, before God can manifest a great destiny in your life, he has to prove it in you that you are going to do exactly what you have been called to do. You will not deviate to the right or the left. Now there's grace, right? There's grace. People make mistakes sometimes, but there's always grace. So that's what he also proves you to make sure that when you do become great, you do not forget. That's why he kept on telling the Israelites in the Old Testament. He said, you have to go through the wilderness so that when you have become great, so that when you have gotten into the land or into the land of promise, that you will not forget me. You will not forget who God is. So God is keeping all these things and he's showing you all these experiences so that you can remember who God is when you finally obtain the promise. Because God is a jealous God and he wants to make sure that you know that it's only because of him that you obtained what you have obtained. So, you know, we have been blessed with every spiritual blessing, but we must also be approved to inherit those blessings. Now, we think that's what one of the things that makes salvation so great and so awesome is, normally, you know, for the blessings of God to manifest in our lives, we have to get proved and approved to use it. But Jesus Christ did all that proving for us. Jesus Christ himself took on that responsibility of proving and approving, as so that we receive salvation freely. But there are certain other things that we cannot walk into unless we get proved. There are certain destinies, certain levels of our destiny that we cannot walk into unless God has proven that when we go into it, we will do it only for God and we will not do it with a prideful heart, because God cannot stand a prideful heart. The Bible says in Psalm 107, 105, verse 17, let's quickly look at that scripture. 105, verse 17, it says in verse 17, God sent a man. Now, when God sent him, you see in verse 18 that he was still in chains. He was still chained up. He was still in prison, right? He said in verse 17, he sent a man before them, even Joseph. But in verse 18, his feet was hot and fertile. So he wasn't even ready to be used or to be sent. But then in verse 19, then God started to prove him by his word. God started to test him. God started to approve him. God started to prove him so he could be approved. And then in verse 20, God made it so that, okay, now he has been approved. And all of a sudden, that man became free. And that man could go out and deliver the Israelites. So you see, there's an order. When God will first call you to something, God will first bless you with something and tell you that this is going to happen in your life. And then the next thing is God is then going to prove you. Then once you are approved, then those things all of a sudden automatically begin to manifest. So before you can manifest the great and mighty things God has for you, you must be proven and approved. Even though God is the one who called you in the first place, God knows that you are capable of doing it, but he's going to prove you just to justify his word. So how do we pass the proving? Just really quickly, how do we pass the proving? Number one is keep his commandments in that area. Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 2 says, and thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee these 40 years in the wilderness to humble thee and to prove you to know what was in your heart, whether thou wilt keep his commandments or no. So God is doing this so that he can prove that you will keep his commandments, so that he can prove that you, when you begin to walk in that manifestation of your destiny, that you do things his way. You will not go your own way. You will not do something that he did not call you to do. He's doing it so that you do things his way. You will keep his commandments. You will keep his law. Number two, how do you pass the proving to be approved? You keep your joy. The Bible says, with joy, which shall you draw water from the well of salvation. Joseph stayed joyful while he was in prison. The Bible says, count it all joy in James chapter 1, verse 2 to 4. It says, count it all joy when you go through diverse temptation, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have a perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. So when you allow the proving to happen in your life, when you go through when you look at all the things that are happening and you say, this must be a proving for something, and you are doing the commandments of God and you are doing the right things, then you know this is a proving, and then you just be patient, because once that thing is over, you become perfect in that area. That's what the Bible is saying here. It says, let patience have a perfect work, that you may be perfect, wanting nothing. So when you see yourself going through one thing or the other in one area of life, and you know for sure it's not because you have done something wrong, and then maybe you ask God, okay, God, is this a proving that you're doing in my life? And you just continue to do the word of God, continue to keep your joy. And then you see, once you come out of it, you become perfect, because God has used that to prove you and approve you so that you can become perfect in that area, so that maybe you can minister to other people, so that you can walk in the blessings in that area. Number three, ask for grace. No matter what it is, God will always give you something that you can handle. God will give you the grace to bear it. James 1:12 says, blessed is the man that endures temptation. That temptation here, there also means proving. Blessed is the man that endures temptation, for he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised. You will receive the crown of life in Jesus' name. We see in Malachi, and finally, we see in Malachi chapter 3, verse 1 to 4, that only when we allow ourselves to be proven by the refiner's fire is our good work and our sacrifices acceptable unto God. If we turn there really quickly, Malachi chapter 3, verse Let's go from verse 2. It says, but who may abide in the day of his coming? Who shall stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and a fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver. And he shall purify the sons of Levi and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness. So God wants to purge you of anything that will not make your good works to be acceptable unto him. I pray that God will give us the grace to handle the project, to be proved and approved in the name of Jesus Christ. As we go into the prayer, let's pray that God will give us grace so we can handle whatever proving process and whatever testing he brings our way in Jesus' name.
Amen, amen. And with that, we'll go into our personal time of prayer with the Lord, and we'll be back shortly.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We thank God for today again. As this week is coming to an end on this platform, we're back on Monday. But the message of today is so important that we get it. Many are going through challenges in life, but don't understand it. We see other people go through challenges. And analyze and twist it the way we like. I'm always amazed at the scripture from Job says, your word has instructed many. You have strengthened the weak hands, but now it comes to you and you are fainting. And then we go through challenges. But because we don't understand it, we fail. And you see, you don't move from one level to a higher level without passing the exam. There are exams of life. Let me read for us from Job 24, verse 8. He said, behold, I go forward, but he's not there. I'm backwards, but I cannot perceive him. Things are just crazy. They are not working. I don't understand this, God. Why am I going through this? He said, on the left, where does he walk? But I cannot behold him. He hided himself on the right, but I cannot see him. He just looks as if God has forsaken you. He looks as if you just cannot see him. But those who understand don't give up on God. He said, but I like that. He knoweth the way that I take. That means despite the challenges, despite the temptations, despite the crisis, I'm still walking his path. He knoweth the way that I take. When he had tried me, he said, I shall comfort as gold. He said, my foot had held his step. His way have I kept and not declined. That means in the midst of challenge. You are going through tough times, yes. So, how are you walking with God in the midst of it all? What do you understand of God in the midst of it all? He said, my foot has held his step. His ways have I kept and not declined. Neither have I gone back from the commandment of his lips. I have esteemed the words of his mouth more than my necessary food. I like that one too, more than my. So it's not just about you, what you want. It's about what he says. That's what could make Joseph to be excited and joyful, even in prison. Not intimidated by what he was going through. But he stood firm with his God. And listen to me, God's people. God will prove you. You were not the first, neither are you going to be the last. That's his way. The trial of faith, he calls it. He said, the trial of your faith, work patience. You won't circumvent the system. You won't shortcut it. There's no shortcut. You will go through it. But going through it, do you give up? Do you look for shortcut? Do you abandon his ways? Psalm 119:92. Unless thy law had been my delight, I should have perished in my affliction. You will not perish in your affliction. But you see, unless you make his word your delight, unless you make his word your delight, it will be another story. When you are in those challenges, when things look tough, when there is so much lack, when there is this and that, what do you do? What is your say? Unless, he said, thy law had been my delight, I should have perished in my affliction. He said, I will never forget thy precepts, for with them thou hast quickened me. I am dying, save me, for I have sought thy precepts. Until the time that his word came, the Bible says, the word of the Lord cried him. You are not the first, neither are you going to be the last. I remember my engineering class days. There's what we call Hooke's law, the theory of elasticity. You'll be stretched to see how far you can go and still retain your sanity, to see how far you can go and still maintain yourself, your walk with God. Am I straightened until it is accomplished? Even Jesus was straightened, right? He said, Jesus Christ, a man approved of God among you. You cannot be approved until you approve. So you are not the fourth. You won't be the last. It's the way of the Spirit. That's why the Bible says God will not allow any temptation greater than you can bear to come your way. For in it, he has made for you a way of escape. What you are going through, God knows you can handle it. So prove to him you can handle it. Without straight, forgetting his precepts, without going the other way, but standing firm in faith, giving glory to God. Your breakthrough is there, it's coming, but there is a path you must go through. Some of us want more challenge, scatter ground, I'm not coming again, and this and that. I once told someone who used to be here, when certain things go, I said, don't you know something about God? God does not check you by what people do to you. God checks you by what you do. I said, can you even see that that was a test from heaven for you, and you just fell flat? Because somebody says something, and you begin to you lose your sense and sanity. And a lot of us are like that. No, those things, somebody is doing something to you, somebody says something to you, just smile and go your way. God is testing your elasticity. Oh, Jesus Christ. Giving in the midst of lack is testing your elasticity. What will God do with your money? He said, if I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. Then the cattle upon a thousand hills, they are mine. Everything. Testing your integrity, your elasticity, your commitment, whether you will be there for him or not. I see this too often. Somebody says something, then you are reacting. Da, 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 da. For what? God is not going to judge you by what they do to you. He's going to judge you by what you do, how you respond, how you act on it, how you take it. We can keep talking on this till the air will end. That's the path you go. But then, like Job said, let me read that before I call the person closing. He said, but he knoweth the path that I take. And when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. When he has tried me, those challenges, those trials of faith, when I pass them, I shall come forth as gold. How do you go through it? By holding up to your steps and its ways and not decline from them. Your day of shining is just around the corner. Don't give up. Don't give up. Stand firm and stand true to God, and you will see His glory manifest in your life. Glory to God. Well, let me hand over to Sister Winifred to close us today.
Amen. We thank God for this day. I would like to bring this to your attention that there is more provision for every one of us for spiritual growth. We encourage you to join the Believers' Meeting. This is the gathering of the saints fellowshipping together, dissecting the Word of God for better understanding. If you really want to know how to study the Bible, you want it to speak to you, then be part of this meeting, which holds every Thursday, 7 p.m. Mountain Time, using the same Zoom link. Let us continue to thank God for this morning devotion program, where we come daily to learn of God and our soul being refreshed with the love of Christ. Let's continue to spread the word. Tell people about it, invite them, and see what God can do through you. You shall be rewarded. This program runs Monday through Friday, 5 a.m. Mountain Time, and we shall return again on Monday by God's grace. May we continue to do that which is right and good in the sight of the Lord. Amen. Let us share the goodness together. Surely, God's goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we continue to dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.